Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is a good morning. Nice day to be here. It's always a nice day to be here. But there are other nice things too, and I'm going to tell you about them. One thing is the pastor's Bible study. If you haven't been to that on Wednesday night, you need to go. It is really informative. Tim is just, I'd say, laid back. He's always laid back. It's a very relaxing, easy study. He says things that you can remember, you know? And I'll just give you one thing that I remember. He said that when we separate ourselves from God because we use our will and not God's will, and that really hit me. I thought, I don't do that.
Do. Yes. I do have something to say about that slide because I think I was supposed to change it. Sorry, everyone. There will not be Wednesday night activities the week of Thanksgiving, but Pastor will be here this Wednesday, so I'm not sure why. That's November 22nd. It's not December, so none this weekend. Not this week or the next week. The following week will be when it resumes after Thanksgiving.
Right.
Yes.
November 22nd?
Sorry.
No, thank you. Sunday supper, but then next week is on. It's a busy month. Okay. As you know, this morning was a little bit chilly. I put on my short sleeve shirt because I have a tendency to get too hot then. Oh, yes. I walked outside and thought, ooh, maybe a long thick shirt would have been good today. But the reason I bring that up is that each year we have a little mission which we collect coats, and it goes to a place called Charlie's Place in D.C. And it's primarily for men, and I just said, Fred, well, what about the women? You know, and they said, well, Charlie says they get enough stuff for women most of the time, because women, you know, I dare say this, the women change their wardrobes more often than men. When we get married, we buy a set of clothes we wear forever. And this, the wife says, that's got to go. Believe it. If you can do that, black for some reason. But they like black coats, and large and extra large is kind of the preference, but anything will do. There's a lot of people that are very, very, wintertime is tough for that. You know, so if you can do that, make it all. Yes, I had a nice little thing happen the other day, which made it easier for me to do something like buy a coat for Charlie's Place. And my daughter said, Dad, I need to meet with you to talk to you about Thanksgiving and Christmas. I said, oh, okay. You know. And one of the first things she said is, this Christmas, you don't buy for the kids. I said, what? And she said, it's getting to be, they're older, you know. The youngest one's 23. She said, you know, it's a little bit too much financially. And the cousins don't buy for each other. And I said, okay. So, and she said, no, it's too. I said, no, I got to buy for my daughters. You know. It'd make it easier for me to go buy a coat for Charlie's Place. So hopefully good things will happen to you like that. And yes?
Just to mention that there's a good sale at Costco on black all-weather coats. They're $5 off. It's only $25.
Wow. Well, thank you. Costco has one sale. Nice coats and warm, you know. So, great. Yes?
When do they do? When do you have to have
them?
Next Sunday?
Because,
next
Sunday.
Next Sunday.
Okay.
Next Sunday. Okay.
Thank you.
If there's no one here, I may hear you. Okay. But this church does a lot for other people, and very mission-oriented. If you're helping other people, that's good. The next thing is Operation Christmas Child. The shoe boxes, my last count was 39, is that right there? 39 boxes so far, and that in next Sunday is the last Sunday, and we'll take those for Chaplains. But anyway, those little boxes are out here that you can pick up if you haven't done it yet and want to do it. They're available first of all. It's really fun. Ted, Fred and I were talking, you may have to go to several different places to find what you want for these kids because it's kind of a variety. But I had really fun doing that. I spent some time at Staples. Staples is a good place to buy stuff for kids, you know, pen and pencils and pens and stuff like that. I also sent a little flashlight that I picked up at a meeting and lots of batteries would go with it and such. Anything like that. Those kids really enjoy this thing. When you don't get nothing, anything is great.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
So,
amen.
Yeah. And we don't, for the most part, we don't know that feeling. You know, my family was not very well off, but Christmas was different. You know, I always got something, you know, that I'd like to get. So when you don't get anything at all, oh, well, that shoebox makes it. And I think they have it. And it's like, yeah, okay, that's that. Okay. I think that's it for right now. Okay. Any questions?
All right, I'm here. Well, good morning. Can you hear me? So you notice things are a little bit different today. I'm Associate Minister Nick Abadi. I'm not Pastor Tim. Pastor Tim is sick. He had a shingles shot on Friday, and yesterday morning he started the phone calls and says, I'm sick. I'm in bed. I've got the chills. I got a fever. You may have to do the services tomorrow. He says, but I may get better enough and I'll call you and tell you. Well, yesterday afternoon at 4 o'clock, he called me and said, I'm not better. He says, I'd appreciate it if you do the services, do everything you do, plus everything else. So here I am in the praise team bullpen, which I'll be playing guitar and preaching and everything else. No, I'm going to go to the pulpit when it's time to preach. When you have a chance, say a quiet prayer amongst yourselves for Pastor Tim that he gets better. Because he is struggling, and we know he hates to miss Sunday services itself. What we're employing today is pulpit supply, which means is that we have a number of people in our church that have been trained to stand in when needed, and that's called lay service, that have been through at least one of the courses through the Leadership Academy. So, after me, you'll see Fred doing the lighting of the candle, bringing in the Christ candles. You'll see Doug, John doing the offertory, and then Fred, and then our worship leader. So we're going to be switching around a lot as we make this all work itself. So I appreciate your indulgence, and also I've got to point out, don't believe anything in the bulletin because we changed it. I want to talk about the men's breakfast yesterday. Martin, where are you? Stand up. Martin Rick gave an excellent presentation on the use of
yes,
one of our newest members of the church, one of our newest members of the men's group itself. And it's great. Where are you in the back there? Stand up. Next week. Who's doing our service, our men's breakfast next week?
Well,
I'll try
to
attend. I don't have my service here. All right, what else do I want to bring up? This is Veterans Day weekend, and we have a host of veterans in our group. I ask you all to stand up for a round of applause, our veterans. Please. Stand up here and tell us about the mission trip, and she says, no, I am going to put a slideshow together and maybe it'll replace one of our sermons that day or something. Especially if I'm speaking. Lastly, I want to call on Sally. Sally, stand up. We've been told it's your birthday tomorrow, so we're going to sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
silent prayer for Pastor Tim for a quick recovery in the evening on this special Wednesday night for the Southern Supper. With that, over to Fred.
At this time, I'll bring the lighting of the fresh candle.
Thank you.
I didn't forget the announcement. The last thing about this congregation is that you can make a mistake and I'll love you anyway. This on Sunday morning, it's 9 o'clock. We do have an adult Bible study class. And this is the third book in the series that we're using. This will start next week. And it's really been very good. Today we're talking about being gentle to other people, particularly in times of it's a little strained, and sometimes that is difficult to do, but it's the way God would have us do. And this is a really good study of the series. This is the third one of the series, so if you get the feeling you want to do that, Sunday morning, 9 o'clock, and we'll get back in the ice room again. So. I grabbed the wrong notes. Remember. this morning, I'd like for you to pray for Jess Brown's sister, Ginger. She's in hospice care, suffering from terminal lung cancer. Janice is trying to relocate her back to her home, which in this case is difficult to do sometimes to get people moved under this kind of condition. So let's pray for Ginger today. Praying for Belinda and Jacob for a fine trip that they had. And this, like I said, this church does a lot of mission type things, and that's one of them. You went to El Salvador. Yeah, wow. How long does it take to get there?
4.5 hours.
Long trip. Yeah. Yeah. Well, look forward to hearing about that. Yeah. I think, of course, yesterday being Veterans Day, we want to include in our prayers our veterans and for our nation. Things could be a lot better in our country right now. And we want to pray for that. So at this point, we are going to a silent prayer for everyone offer their own prayers to God, and they want everyone's prayer. Now the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
Well, I use one all the time. And what you do is you put it up to someone's heart and you listen, right? Well, doctors also use stethoscopes. And what does the doctor do with it? They listen to what's going on inside of our bodies. A person might not look very healthy on the outside and have something wrong on the inside. Many doctors want to see their patients once a year for a checkup. Do you ever go to the doctor for a checkup? If so, you know the routine. They check to see how tall you are and how much you weigh. They look in your eyes, ears, nose, and throat. Then the doctor takes this stethoscope, which feels as if this has been kept in the refrigerator, right? It's always cold, and listens to see if your heartbeat is strong and steady. Any unusual sound may tell the doctor that something's wrong with your heart. If the doctor finds something wrong, you might need some medicine to make it well. Sometimes the doctor finds something wrong and has to operate to fix it. There have even been some cases when a person needed a whole new heart. Isn't it wonderful that God has given us doctors who can fix our heart when something goes wrong? Well, our Bible story today is about a man named David. You remember David, don't you? David was a shepherd boy that God made to become a king. He also slew the giant Goliath with a slingshot. David loved God with all of his heart, but he didn't always do what God wanted him to do. Sometimes David had heart trouble. Yeah, you heard it right. It wasn't the kind of heart trouble you could hear with a stethoscope, though. But David knew he had heart trouble. He knew that he had sinned and done wicked and evil things in God's sight. So what did David do about his heart problem? He went to the one that he knew could fix it. He went to God. David prayed to God and said, "Oh God, I have sinned against you and I have done evil things in your sight. Create in me a clean heart and give me a right spirit." Sometimes you and I have heart problems too. We might have some things in our heart that shouldn't be there. Things like bitterness, anger, jealousy, selfishness, pride, and greed. When we come to church, everything may look great on the outside, but God may look inside and see that our heart isn't right. When we know that we have a heart problem, we need to do what David did. We need to pray to God and say, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." Do you have some things in your heart that shouldn't be there? You know, I'm not perfect. I know I do. Let's ask God to fix it. Let's pray. Dear Father, we know that you can see what is in our heart, and we know that there are some things there that shouldn't be there. Create a clean heart in us, O God. Amen.
Okay, I'm glad you're here, Mr. McGonagall, because I want to say to you what a wonderful job you do. I really think that this collection of your lessons on the morning could be put together on a national level so that it can spread. It's really well done, and you do it so well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's not it. I'm not even going to tell you what the scripture reading is because you will recognize it. Okay. This is the scripture reading for this morning. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I often kid with Pastor Tim that my best sermons are written Saturday night at 10 o'clock. Yesterday he called me on that because he says, I'm not coming. Can you prepare your message? Well, I finished it up at about 11:15 last night. And the biggest problem, more than anything else, wasn't the sermon, because I already had a sermon prepared for the 8 o'clock service, so I had to add to it. But wouldn't you know it, that the printer did not want to work, and nothing is more frustrating when you have a sermon in your computer and you can't get it to print. So I reset the network, I reset all the computers, I prayed a lot, and I finally got it to print. So happy Veterans Day, everyone. All of us veterans know the 23rd Psalm, probably taught to us by our drill instructor, or flight commander, or our parents who were possibly World War II veterans, such as my father was. I entered active duty in 1968 during the Vietnam era, and I was taught, the Lord is my shepherd. I fear no evil, because I am the meanest blank, blank, blank in the jungle. I think Tom Hanks said this in his famous Forrest Gump movie. Psalm 23, I slightly modified it in honor of the veterans who were God-fearing men and who have pressed on in the face of fear, but also pressed on in the name of the Lord. Now, why I use the 23rd Psalm? I really think David was probably our first military veteran who entered combat and prayed as he went into it himself. What I wrote as I modified it is, the Lord is my shepherd, as modified by me. The Lord is my trainer and drill instructor, who I fear more than anything else. I should not fear the fight. He is constantly with me, working with my fellow comrades in arms. He refreshes me between skirmishes and with sound advice. And yea, that I walk into the battlefield to stare an enemy twice my size, even then he will be with me. His hands on my shoulders, and his words to guide me. With his armament support at my side, and his angels abound, he will care for me as long as the battles of my life. And when the final bugle call sounds, I shall retire from the front, knowing that I fought the good fight with the Lord at my side. Now, that was not, obviously, the 23rd Psalm, but I paraphrased to make a point itself. Military members, especially as we recall them and think about them on this Veterans Day, many, many, many times pray when things are going bad. I understand the central theme of the 23rd Psalm, namely calling on God in times of fear and calling on the Holy Spirit and godly men in our lives to provide guidance and faith to see our assigned mission through. I served 27 years in the Air Force, and at times of stress, I would call upon the Lord for guidance, but also in mind, I would think of the sermons of Father Ray. Now, who's Father Ray? Nick, I'm bringing something up from 60 years ago plus. Father Ray was very, very cool and a collective matter. He was a Catholic priest and served in the Navy Military Chaplaincy Corps. So this Veterans Day weekend, we call our attention to our military veterans who may have seen combat or been long absences from family or may have been placed in a very difficult position. I was one of those who was placed in a very, very difficult position, afraid I was going to start World War III. I was a technical operations manager aboard a missile tracking ship somewhere in the northern Pacific off the coast of Kamchatka. I was a senior military officer on that ship. 13 Soviet naval warships passed by me. And I was thinking, here we have the Pueblo all over again. So what did I do? Well, obviously I prayed a lot. And I asked the good Lord to guide me, to give me strength. I listened to what Father Ray said to me a year or two before that. He says, in times of stress in your military life, in times of difficulty in your military life, be cool. Be Fonzie. Fonzie was years later. That's beside the point. But be cool. Keep your composure.
Remember, the Lord is with you. Pray to the Lord as you're thinking, what do I do next? So what did I do? Now you're going to have to wait until I write my autobiography. And I'll tell you that. I mentioned military chaplains, and they too should be recognized on Veterans Day for their bravery and devotion to the Lord. Military chaplains are men of God. This morning I thought it best to honor our veterans, to look at veterans of military service and faith, such as military chaplains. Now, a number of us have all stood up and said, we were veterans, we did that earlier this morning. But we can all think of a military chaplain that we were associated with in our military career. One of the first people you meet when you go to boot camp is the chaplain itself. And you say to the chaplain, dear Lord, did I make a mistake? Why am I here? Yes. What is a military chaplain? According to Wikipedia, a military chaplain ministers to military personnel and their families. Although the term chaplain originally had Christian roots, it is generally used today in military organizations to describe all professionals spiritually trained to serve in any special need, regardless of their religious affiliation. Now, what does that mean, really? That means a Catholic priest who is a military chaplain may be asked to perform or to perform a Jewish ceremony like a bar mitzvah or a bris, because there may not be a rabbi available, and the military member of the military family says, I want to do this. So he's trained to do what he needs to do, spiritually, religiously, even though that was not his denomination. Now, it really gets tough when you have a military member who maybe believe in Islam. And that's difficult for a military chaplain to perform a service in that regard. Let me tell you about a couple examples of bravery, pure bravery and faith from military chaplains. It was the evening of 2nd of February, 1943, and the U.S. Army transport ship Dorchester was crowded to capacity. The ship's captain was concerned and cautious, knowing that they were in dangerous waters. German U-boats were constantly prowling, and there were several sinkings. The Dorchester was only 150 miles from its final destination, but the captain ordered the men to sleep in their uniforms and to keep their life jackets on. Now remember, these are young soldiers, and who is he to tell me what I'm going to do? And it's cold out here. So, however, many soldiers chose to sleep deep in the ship's hold next to the engine room because of the heat that it generated, and disregarded the captain's order. Others ignored the order to wear their life jackets because it was uncomfortable. So they chucked them, put them aside. On February 3rd, next day at 12:55 a.m., a periscope broke the chilly Atlantic waters. Through the crosshairs of the scope, an officer aboard the German submarine spotted the Dorchester and fired torpedoes. One of the torpedoes hit far below the waterline. Moments later, the captain of the Dorchester, realizing how seriously damaged the ship was, gave orders to abandon ship into the cold of land. In less than 20 minutes, the Dorchester would sink. Panic and chaos set in. Men jumped from the ship into the lifeboats, overcrowding them to the point of capsizing. Through the chaos, four chaplains brought hope and in despair and light in the darkness. These chaplains were Lieutenant George Fox, a Methodist, Lieutenant Alex Good, a Jewish rabbi, Lieutenant John Washington, a Roman Catholic priest, and Lieutenant Clark Poling, a minister for the Dutch Reformed. Quickly and quietly, the four spread out among the soldiers. They tried to calm the frightened, tended to the wounded, and guided the disoriented toward safety. One army private found himself floating in oil-smeared water, surrounded by dead bodies and debris. He said, when he was rescued, I could hear men crying, pleading, praying, he called. I could hear the chaplains preaching courage while I was in the water. Their voices were the only thing that kept me going. Another sailor, John Mahoney, tried to re-enter his cabin, but Rabbi Good stopped him. The seller, concerned about the cold Arctic sea, explained he had forgotten his gloves. Never mind, Chaplain Good responded. I have two pairs. The rabbi then gave the petty officer his own gloves. By this time, most of the men were topside out of the bows of the ship, and the chaplains opened the storage locker and began distributing life jackets. Now remember, they had tossed their life jackets aside and were now standing topside without life jackets. It was then that engineer Grady Clark witnessed an astonishing sight. When there were no more life jackets in the storage closet, the chaplains removed their life jackets and gave them to four frightened young soldiers. It was the finest thing I've ever seen or hoped to see this side of heaven, said John Ladd, another survivor who saw their chaplain's selfless act. The action of the four chaplains constituted one of the purest spiritual and ethical acts a person can make. When given their life jackets, Rabbi Hood did not call out for a Jew. Father Washington did not call out for a Catholic, nor did Reverend Fox and Coleman call out for a Protestant. They simply gave their life jackets to the next man in line. As the ship went down, survivors in nearby rafts and boats could hear and see the four chaplains, arms linked and braced against the slanting back. Their voices could also be heard offering prayers for their fellow soldiers and sailors now in the water. Father Vincent Robert Capodanno, who was a Catholic priest and a Maryknoll missioner, who was serving in the Navy as a chaplain with the Marine Corps Infantry Unit during the Vietnam War. On Labor Day, September 4th, 1967, and I think Steve, you were in those waters about that time, Gulf of Tonkin. The Marine position was attacked on their ninth defensive position by a large People's Army of Vietnam unit, approximately 2,500 Vietnamese or Vietnam soldiers attacked this military outpost of Marines. The outnumbered and disorganized Marine Corps Company needed to support Company B and was sent to assist. By 9 a.m., 26 Marines were confirmed dead. The commander of the 1st Battalion requested additional reinforcements, and the companies K and M from the 3rd Battalion were committed to the battle, still leaving the Marines greatly outnumbered by the mass of the vast People's Army of Vietnam. When Father Cadapo heard that two platoons of M Company from his battalion were taking casualties and was about to be overrun by the enemy, the unarmed chaplain went to the wounded in the battlefield and dying Marines and helping them and comforting them. And when he saw the wounded Marines that were seriously wounded, he gave them last rites and absolution. Although he was wounded severely in his hands and arms and legs, he refused medical evacuation. And then, later, he went out to help a seriously wounded Navy corpsman and two wounded Marines who were unknowingly lying within yards from the enemy machine gun post. Father Capodanno reached him and was cut down by a machine gun and killed instantly. Why did these military chaplains act so bravely? They were military men of God with immeasurable faith in the Lord. And similar to David, walking into the shadow of death, they feared not because they knew the Lord was with them. And if not here, then in the hereafter. Happy Veterans Day, all. Amen. Next.
John? Thank you, Dick. Pastor Tim, every Sunday, says something about this, and we do appreciate your tithes and gifts and offerings. For 233 years, our Heavenly Father has sustained this church, and it's through those gifts and tithes and offerings that we can continue. So, Lord, we return these gifts and tithes to you. And as the psalmist says, all we can do is look to you and your strength and seek your face. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Take the light of Christ out into the world. Let us reflect on the first chapter of John, starting with verse 9, where it states, "The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through the world was made through him. The world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. As children of God, you saw fit for us to gather and worship you this morning. It is not because we are perfect people, but because you are an awesome God and is worthy of our worship. Thank you for making us worthy to stand before you to worship you through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the time that we have shared together with you this morning. And as we leave this morning, please keep Pastor Tim in our prayers. And now, as children of God, let us go in peace, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.